Good morning. Welcome to All Came to Worship. Today is the last Sunday of Epiphany, also known as Transfiguration Sunday. And our focus for today is going to be Jesus Christ has been manifested as the Almighty King of Glory. Today we're going to be following TLH page 5. We begin with a hymn from the Worship Supplement, hymn 720, O Wondrous Type, O Vision Fair, Supplement 720.
Son to die for us. Have mercy upon us, his sake, grant us remission of all our sins. And by thy Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of thee and of thy will, and true obedience to thy word, to the end that by thy grace we may come to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy on us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To those who believe on his name, he gives the power to become children of God and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. Awake! Why do you sleep, O Lord?
Arise, do not cast us off forever.
Why hide you your face?
And forget our affliction.
Our soul is bowed down to the dust.
Arise for our help and redeem us.
We have heard with our ears, O God.
Our fathers have told us what work you did in their days. Today is Transfiguration. Our lesson for today are going to help us focus on the fact that Jesus is the King of Glory. In our first lesson, we're going to be talking about the death of Moses. Now, without a doubt, Moses was one of the greatest prophets. In fact, our text will even tell us that there was never a prophet like him.
It's one who saw God face to face, one with whom God talked like a friend, who actually got to see the glory of God with his ears. And yet, Moses died. He died because he sinned against God. And because of that, he was not allowed to enter the promised land. In our text, we'll see that God showed him the promised land, but he was not allowed to enter it. That would have to go to Joshua, successor. Ironically, on Transfiguration, Jesus is going to be talking with Moses. And just as Moses passed on the mantle to Joshua, so in a spiritual way, Moses must pass the mantle to the new Joshua, Greek name Jesus. Jesus is better than even the greatest of Old Testament prophets, Moses. Because Moses sinned and died. Our first lesson, Deuteronomy chapter 34, the first 12 verses. Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho. And the Lord showed him all the land, Gilead as far as Dan, all Naphtali, the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the Negev, the plain that was in the valley, the Negev and the plain that is the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, as far as Zoar. And the Lord said to him, "This is the land of which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, I will give it to your offspring. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not go over there." So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there, in the land of Moab, according to the word of the Lord. And he buried him in the valley in the land of Moab, opposite Beth Peor. But no one knows the place of his burial to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eye was undimmed, and his vigor unabated. And the people of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab for 30 days. Then the days of weeping and mourning for Moses were ended. And Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands on him. So the people of Israel obeyed him, and did as the Lord had commanded Moses. And there has not arisen a prophet since in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. None like him for all the signs and the wonders that the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt, to Pharaoh, and to all his servants, and to all his land, and for all the mighty power, and all the great deeds of terror that Moses did in the sight of all Israel. Here ends our first lesson. Our psalm for this morning, Psalm 99, confirms that Moses was indeed a great prophet, also a priest, but verse 9 reminds us, but God still had to punish him as he had disobeyed him. I want to point out, however, please note that in verses 3 and verse 5, the congregation's verse is really, really short. It's, holy is he. And so that's going to happen twice, whereas just a very quick, holy is he. So, all right. Psalm 99 as printed, responsibly by half verse.
Forever, I am thy God.
as the builder of a house has more honor than the house itself. or every house is built by someone, but the builder of all things is God. Now Moses was faithful in all God's house as a servant to testify to the things that were to be spoken later. But Christ is faithful over God's house as a son. And we are his house. If indeed we hold fast to our confidence and are boasting in our hope. Here ends our second lesson. Will the congregation please stand in reverence for the gospel? The Holy Gospel, which serves as the basis for our sermon text, is taken from the 9th chapter of St. Luke. We begin reading at the 28th verse. Here we will see that Jesus is certainly a prophet like Moses. God himself says, listen to him. But he is also a son. He is the Lord of glory because he is our Savior. Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And as he was praying, the appearance of his face was altered, and his clothing became dazzling white. And behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was about to accomplish in Jerusalem. Now, Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. And as the men were parting from him, Peter said to Jesus, Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah, not knowing what he said. And as he was saying these things, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him. When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent and told no one in those days anything of what they had seen. This is the gospel of our Lord.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated as we continue with another hymn out of the supplement, hymn 719, Jesus on the Mountain Peak.
Thank you.
meditation this morning is the Gospel appointed for today, Transfiguration Sunday, Luke chapter 9, verses 28 to 36. As we've already read that, I'll just remind you of verse 33. And as the men were parting from him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. This is God's word. Grace, mercy, and peace are yours from God our Father, through our transfigured Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is the image of the invisible God, my dear friends in Christ. They say seeing is believing. But if that were true, why did God remove the vision? Peter, James, and John were amazed at what they saw, but as they are marveling in the glory, God brought a cloud to obscure their vision. Matthew, in fact, calls it a cloud of light, not just an ordinary fog, but the glory of God purposefully hid the glory of Jesus and Moses and Elijah. Why? Perhaps because seeing is misbelieving. It seems that Peter, James, and John, the apostles, well, pretty much all the Jews expected that the Messiah would come, kick out the Romans, and set up a kingdom in Israel. Woohoo! And when they finally got to see Jesus in his glory, Peter probably thought, "This is going to be awesome." So God covers up that glory, and he says, "I want you to see better. I want you to see more clearly. I want you to think about what you're seeing, not with your eyes, but with your ears." Just like Moses, long ago, 1400 years dead, but 1400 years ago, he says, "Now God, show me your glory." God says, "All right. Stand in the cleft," and he covered up his face, and he showed the glory with his ears. The Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, forgiving love, showed with his ears. So also God says once again, "This is my chosen son. Listen to him. See with your ears, not with your eyes." Because seeing with your eyes might be misbelieving. But if you see with your ears, you will see, one, this guy is God. Two, this God gets gored. And three, the gore is good. Look closely with your ears. And Jesus will have told you just before this mountaintop experience, it's time for the Son of Man to go to Jerusalem. He will be betrayed. He will be put into the hands of Gentile sinners. The Jews will reject him. The Gentiles will kill him. Crucify him. And on the third day he will rise again. That didn't quite fit with the picture of what Peter and James and John wanted their Messiah to be. In fact, there was one time Jesus says, "No, Jesus, that ain't going to happen to you." And Peter and Jesus said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are not thinking like God, you're thinking like a human." So what does it mean to think like a human? From 1940 to 1989, Siegbert Becker was Dr. Becker was a pastor in the Wells. He didn't join the CLC, so evidently he didn't understand Romans 16, 17. But he had some fantastic sermons. And even nearly 100 years ago, he was pointing out that even then, there were people that were getting critical of the miracles. Even then, there were people not outright denying the miracles, but just saying, let's not focus on that. But, for example, the feeding of the 5,000, that shows that we should all care and share, and the lunch can go amazing places. The walking on the water shows that we should help each other out in the storms of life. The healing of the sick and of the blind shows that we need to have compassion on those less fortunate than us. Even preaching good news to the poor means that we should support welfare and all kinds of humanitarian aids. But when it comes to today's miracle, the Transfiguration, that kind of puts these naysayers at a loss. Because all these other miracles, even the resurrection, shows that we should overcome our causes and have a whole new life. But the Transfiguration, that didn't help anybody. That didn't do any social justice to anybody. So what's the point of that miracle? It confirms what all the other miracles say. This guy is God. When God speaks, we should listen. When God says, here's the plan, we shouldn't say, no, I got a better idea. How about this instead? This is God. He knows what he's talking about. He knows what he's doing. And it is so important that we see that. Otherwise, the next 40 days are going to make no sense. Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. Ash Wednesday is when we begin the 40 days of Lent. And if we don't understand that this guy is God, then we're not going to understand Lent. The truth of the matter is, this guy is God. And he told them repeatedly, I'm going to Jerusalem to suffer and to die. In fact, Jesus kind of had to help that along. Recall what John says when they came to arrest him. Who is it you seek? Jesus of Nazareth. I am. And at the I am, they all fell back to the ground. Jesus just waits. Who is it you seek? Jesus of Nazareth? I told you I am. If you're here to arrest me, let these guys go. And when Peter decided to take things into his own hands and draw a sword, Jesus stopped him and healed Malchus. Jesus enabled this because Jesus was on a mission. As much as Peter and James and John, as much as we also would like to bask in the glory, Jesus says there is a mission first, and it's not glorious, it's gory. The cross was a horrible way to die. In fact, Romans wouldn't even let Roman citizens be crucified. Jesus said he was going to be. God was going to be crucified. If you listen to the Burning and Blessing podcast, you know that recently they had one out, the common question. If there's a God, why does he tolerate so much suffering? Why doesn't God fix it? That question shows a complete misunderstanding of God's glory, of our sin, and of God's grace. God's glory is such that he cannot tolerate any sinful rebellion. and sinful rebellion must be punished. Our sins, we might try to minimize them, we might forget about them, we might try to sweep them under the carpet, but God, in His greatness, cannot. He cannot just ignore sin. And so when we realize just how sinful we are and how glorious God is, we understand we deserve a lot worse than what we got. But in the cross, amazing of all amazingness, God not only does something about it, He doesn't stop it, He takes it. He says, take all that sin, put it on my Son, and kill Him. Pierce Him through. Let His blood pay for your sin. It is a gory business, cleansing sin. But Jesus was willing. Not just willing, He was eager. In fact, Hebrews tells us, for the joy set before Him, He scorned the shame of the cross. Why? How? Because Jesus knew that this gore is good. It is the only way to cleanse sin. And it worked. It worked. His blood cleanses all sin. Even the sin of people who died before Jesus was born. Moses had been dead for 1400 years. And he appeared in glory talking to Jesus. Because Jesus' gore worked. Elijah, so-called the last of the prophets, never really died. He was just taken to heaven in a whirlwind. And yet, here he appears in glory. Proof that Jesus worked. He succeeded. Jesus cleansed us of our sin and gives us a future, not as glorious as His, but certainly much more glorious than we deserve. Jesus knew that all along. That's why He insisted on going to Jerusalem, on being betrayed, on dying, and rising again on the third day. This is something we need to focus on with our ears. Peter didn't even know what he was saying when he mentioned the three shelters. He didn't understand, so we certainly don't understand what he was thinking either. But most likely he was thinking of the Feast of Tabernacles, the Feast of Booths, where they would commemorate God coming during the wilderness wanderings and God providing. And now God is coming again and God is going to provide. And Jesus makes it very clear, no, this is not the glory time yet. First we have gore. Then comes the glory. And just as Peter then, so also people today don't want the cross. We don't want to suffer. We want God to make everything right. He will. He did legally, forensically. And He will. But realize that for God to make everything right, that means He must punish all sin. And if there's one believer who doesn't believe yet, they would go to hell. God doesn't want that. We don't want that. And so, yes, the glory is coming. But first, the cross. Peter needed to be reminded of that. We need to be reminded of that. So before we begin our 40-day journey of Lent, doesn't count the Sundays, they don't count, they're still being Easters, but 40 days, not counting Sundays, before we begin that 40-day version, I want you to see with your ears This guy is God. This God is Gore. But this Gore is good. This is Transfiguration. Amen. Jesus reminded his disciples, "For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Division conflict and strife in our country would give way to unity, peace, and quietness. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Quick announcement. First of all, at that point, I was kind of thinking of Russia and Ukraine and all that stuff. Hopefully, keep them in your prayers. Also, we have a prayer request. My son is getting married this summer. His fiance is, her mother, Sherry, just had a stroke last week. Evidently, the last couple of days, she's been unresponsive, and this morning, it got worse. And so Michaela is on her way to go visit her now. We haven't heard how she's doing, but we'll keep Sherry in our prayers as we pray for the sick and possibly even dying. Father of all comfort, as we follow the way of your apostles into your presence, you join our prayers to the ceaseless petitions of your dear Son. Hear us for the sake of the troubled, the sick, and the dying, especially for Sherry and all others who need your care. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, we gratefully remember on this day the glorious manifestation of your Son's divinity on the Mount of Transfiguration. Teach us to listen to Jesus and ever fix our eyes on him and his innocent sufferings and death for our forgiveness. By your grace and mercy, strengthen us to remain faithful in all circumstances of trial, temptation, and persecution. Preserve us to the end, that we may die a blessed death, believing in your beloved Son, with whom you are well pleased. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who taught us to pray,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated as we continue with hymn 135, 'Tis Good, Lord, to Be Here.
Is good, Lord, to be here.
Grant, Almighty God, unto your church your Holy Spirit and the wisdom that comes down from above, that your word may not be bound, but have free course, and may be preached to the joy and edifying of Christ's holy people, that in steadfast faith we may serve you, and in the confession of your name abide unto the end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Thank you.
morning.
Welcome once again to all who came to worship. I hope you enjoyed yourself, but more importantly, I hope you see that Jesus is superior to Moses. He is the Son. He is our Savior.